Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 16th meeting of the Rural Affairs and Islands Committee in 2023. Before we begin, can I remind all those members using electronic devices to please switch them to silent? Our first item of business is to decide on taking items 4 and 5 in private. Are we agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. Our next item of business is an evidence session with the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs, Land Reform and Islands on the National Islands Plan Annual Report 2022. And we have a tight 90 minutes scheduled for this session. So welcome to the meeting, Mary Gujon, the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs, Land Reform and Islands, and in person, Nicola Crook, the National Island Plan Team Leader. No, we don't. We have someone else. Beg your pardon. We've got Francesco Sindico, I hope I pronounced that right, who is the lead for the Carbon Neutral Islands Project. And we have Erica Clarkson, the Joint Head of Division Rural and Islands Future, and Cameron Anson, the Repopulation Island Communities Policy Manager, who's remotely. And we have Nicola Crook, who I think is also remote. And Nicola's a National Island Plan Team Leader. Before my voice gives up, I'm going to invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement.
Oh, thank you very much, Convener, and thank you for inviting me here to discuss the Scottish Government's third annual report on our delivery of the National Islands Plan for 2022. As in previous years, the report summarises the progress that has been made in relation to each of the commitments within the National Islands Plan, and it provides the details of projects and any relevant resource spend too. And it also provides me with the opportunity to put on record my thanks to local authorities, to our island stakeholders, community groups, individuals and businesses for the support that they've given over the course of the last year. Their continued input and collaboration is absolutely key to our delivery of the National Islands Plan. And I also just want to take a moment to acknowledge the working commitment of the government's islands team over the course of the past year. Some of them are islanders themselves or living now on islands, so it really does give government a great source of real-life experience, knowledge and expertise when it comes to the issues that islanders face. However, our island communities still face many challenges across the board that have only been amplified by the likes of COVID-19 and the current cost crisis. And sadly, all that we warned would happen with Brexit is happening, and that long-term harm to the well-being of our islands can't be underestimated. The National Islands Plan continues to provide Scottish Government with a framework to improve the lives of people on islands, and I'm really pleased to see continued progress across the National Islands Plan 13 strategic objectives as is outlined in the annual report. And I just want to provide a couple of quick examples which demonstrate the breadth of work that has been undertaken. Firstly, we've delivered the £4.45 million Islands Programme across all six island local authorities to enable us to work together to support critical projects and to really help make our islands even better places to live, study, work and raise a family. And additionally, the £1.4 million Islands Cost Crisis Emergency Fund was provided directly to island local authorities in order to support them to take that urgent action to help households through the cost crisis. Housing continued to be a key focus for our island communities in 2022. Our National Islands Plan commits us to improving access to homes for people looking to settle in or return to island communities. And delivering against this commitment, we've been developing a remote rural and islands housing action plan to ensure we meet the housing needs of those areas and help retain people and attract them to these communities too. And finally, our innovative Carbon Neutral Islands project continues to support our mission to maximise the opportunities of the green economy for Scotland's islands. We've been working really closely with communities on Cumbrae, Isla, Barra, Rasay, Hoy and Yell to support them in undertaking in-depth carbon audits, which in turn is providing that input into the six community climate change action plans. And just in drawing to a close, Convener, we continue to progress delivery of the National Islands Plan. As required by the Islands Scotland Act 2018, the plan will be fully reviewed in the current year to make sure it remains fit for purpose, and I really look forward to the committee's input to that review process. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I'm going to kick off with a couple of questions. Can you tell the committee what the key areas of progress that have been achieved in meeting the National Islands Plan objectives? And can you give us some examples? Because when we look down at the strategic objectives and the commitments, it would appear there's 133 commitments, but as of now, halfway through the five-year plan, we've only had 26 fulfilled. So can you tell us the main achievements that have been made in the last 2-3 years?
I'd be happy to outline that, but I think it's also important to remember, well, first of all the commitments are now either fulfilled or they're ongoing, because some of the commitments won't simply be, we won't be able to just tick them off, because they will be ongoing commitments as we go through. So I think if you look through some of the strategic objectives and some of the projects that are underway, whether that's under Objective 11, we look at supporting arts, heritage and culture. Again, this is something we will continue to do. So some of the commitments that are ongoing in relation to that and in other areas will, of course, be ongoing rather than be completely fulfilled. But I think that we've fulfilled an additional 5 commitments on progress on last year. I think some of the key areas of progress within that time are when you look at Strategic Objective 12 and what we'd set out there, the commitments in relation to the Young Islanders Network. I was happy to be able to launch that network in the summer in Orkney last year. So we've really seen the development of that. We have it's been great to see the Young Islanders also join our National Islands Plan delivery group and feature in that. As part of that as well, they also feature on the Islands Programme investment panel. So I think it's really been great to see how that network has been developed and how that has continued to grow and increase its engagement. Another example of one that we have achieved, another commitment that we've achieved, is in relation to the islands passport. So that's been launched and HITRANS are continuing to monitor that. There were also a few commitments in relation to NPF4. So of course NPF4 is now being implemented, and I think the commitments that we put forward in relation to the National Islands Plan and that recognition of our islands community have been recognised within that as well. And as I say, there were a number of commitments in relation to that, and also not to forget the Islands Programme itself. I was proud to announce the 13 projects that had been successful in the funding round for that, which was launched earlier this year. So I think you can continue to see from the commitments that we've set out there and the implementation route map alongside that, that there is an awful lot of work that is still ongoing while we have fulfilled some of the commitments based on where we were last year.
So you can understand why, when you look at the commitments and halfway through it appears that there's only a fraction actually being fulfilled, that you know, were raising concerns. But can you give us some examples or expand on the reasons why progress against some of the strategic objectives, so for example, population decline, economic development, transport and digital connectivity, are not being met? You know, digital connectivity certainly jumps out at me. There was 8 commitments, but none have been fulfilled by the end of 2022. Digital connectivity is obviously absolutely critical now. So why have we not seen any improvement in that?
I don't think it's fair to say there's been no improvement, because again, an awful lot of work has been ongoing in relation to that, and I think you can see that from what's set out in the strategic objectives and the commitments there as well. So I mean you can look at Project Gigabit as an example of that too. £20 million of Scottish Government funding, £16 million from the UK Government as well to really expand on the R100 programme. We've also seen, I think I remember talking in my committee appearance last year about the subsea cables that were to be laid as well. So that work has been completed. So we are continuing with that rollout. But I think it's also important to remember that when we first brought forward this plan, that was in 2019, and it was 3 months before the pandemic. So I think there's no denying the absolutely massive impact that had, not just in relation to the implementation of our objectives and the commitments there. I mean, it had an impact right across the country, right across all parts of government, where we really had to pivot our resource to deal with those immediate challenges that we were facing. So I think there has been some delay in relation to that because of those challenges. But again, having resilient communities was really important. And that's where we really pivoted those funds that we had as well. If you look at the previous rounds of the Islands Programme that we had, the funding we provided, the Islands Infrastructure Fund, Healthy Islands Fund, Island Communities as Fund, was to help us deal with some of those challenges as well and react to that. So I do just think it's really important to bear that in mind.
Okay, so when it comes to the digital connectivity, we've got 2.5 years until the end of this current plan. Are you confident that we will get super fast broadband to everybody in the island communities? That's along with the R100 and the gigabit scheme. Are you confident that's going to be delivered?
I mean, I am confident we will continue to make progress on that. I mean, as I say, you can see the progress that we've made over the course of the last year. This work is continuing and it is ongoing.
OK, thank you. Rachel Hamilton.
Convener, very much a similar question to you in terms of the R100 being completed by 2028. And I'm just want some reassurance from the Cabinet Secretary that there will be progress before the 5 years of the plan have expired.
Yes, I mean, you can see that work is ongoing just now. I mentioned Project Gigabit there and the specific areas that they'll be targeting within that. So there will continue to be that progress.
Jim Fairley.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Morning, Cabinet Secretary. The 2018 Act states that annual reports must contain information about the extent to which outcomes in the National Alliance Plan have improved in the reporting year. How would you say that the outcomes for ALNC communities have improved since 2019?
I think that we can see that from some of the commitments that are in the plan there as well. As I say, a lot of these commitments will be ongoing because we want to see continued improvement. I don't think you would like it if I came here to the committee and outlined that, OK, well, we've ticked a box, we can move on and focus on something else. But I think that the review of the National Alliance Plan that I talked about is also really important too, because we've got to make sure that the objectives that we have within it still meet the needs of our island communities and reflect the priorities that they want to see us focusing on too. But I think when you look right across the board and the full suite of objectives that we have there, we are continuing to work on, for example, when you look at Strategic Objective 1 and population, there are a number of threads of work that are ongoing there. We're working on the Talent Attraction and Migration Service. We're also continuing to work on the Addressing Depopulation Action Plan as well, which is a key commitment within that too. So we are continuing to work and try where we can and wherever possible to improve the outcomes for our island communities.
So you talked about the £4.1 million, the latest round of funding. I think I'm right in saying there's an additional £2 million of funding going to the South Uist Community Centre. How has these funding awards been received locally? And what does the government hope they're going to achieve? And I'm presuming that the island communities are pleased to have this extra funding.
Yes, and that's where the projects through the Islands Programme have very much been developed with communities as well, in trying to identify and address those needs. So I think the funding for the projects which I announced last week were welcome, and I was in Shetland announcing three projects that had been awarded funding there. I would also just to thank the committee, I think, for the scrutiny and the work that they undertook on the Islands Programme, because that really helped feed into the process and how we worked the allocation and the models that we use for that funding this year. So I think that feedback was really helpful, and as a result we made improvements to the programme as a result of that work too.
There is a requirement for strategic indicators for the strategic objectives. Sorry, can't get my tongue around that. Have these indicators actually been developed?
Yes, if you look at Strategic Objective 13 and the overall implementation, it's identified a number of pieces of work that needed to be done to enable us to really gather the data that we needed, because we know if we want to ensure that there is effective implementation of the plan, we need the data to inform that and to ensure that we can monitor that. And we knew that there was quite a lot of work to be undertaken to enable us to gather that and then take it forward from there. So from Strategic Objective 13, you can see that we've undertaken five projects to really try and improve that data programme. There's the Islands Data Dashboard, there's the National Islands Plan survey that was undertaken in 2020. So that was undertaken by GHI. I think there were about 4,500 surveys completed from that. We'd sent out just over 20,000. I'm sure officials will correct me if I'm wrong in relation to that. We had about a 22% return rate in relation to that. And just to add to that as well, we've recently commissioned another survey to be undertaken, because now that we have that baseline data, we can then look to build on that for the future too. There's also the work that's been undertaken on geography data zones, island region population dashboard, and the existing data indicators framework, where we've commissioned ECOS to do some work in relation to that and look at what existing indicators we can use to really try and help us to analyse this as best as we can and try and monitor that progress.
So there's ongoing monitoring to make sure that these things...
Yes, there will be. That's where all these different strands of work have been really important. First of all, in ensuring that we can get that that baseline data, as I talked about, the survey helped provide us with, but how we can actually ensure that we can disaggregate the data for islands from the mainland. That's been a challenge in itself. I don't know if Francesco or any other officials would want to discuss some of the, you know, why that has been such a challenge so far and why, again, all these different strands of work are really important in building that picture and ensuring that for each of our islands we are building an accurate picture.
Happy just to jump in very briefly, and also some of my colleagues remotely may want to add. I mean, even in my own experience, obviously I'm more linked to the Carbon Neutral Island project, but the amount of interest from island communities to better understand the disaggregated data at a granular level is huge, but also huge is the challenge to get that data. And the four or five projects that Cabinet Secretary mentioned are a very, very important start. But as Cabinet Secretary said, it's an ongoing effort. And both in this National Islands Plan and in the current review that we will start very soon, data and understanding how we can reach out to really the local data. But for example, one key challenge, when you're talking about a very small island with a very small population, one would want to know absolutely everything, having data, but actually also consider the privacy aspects. Because if you only have 80, 90 people on an island, you start disaggregating and having statistics, well, you'll clearly know who's who. And that's also something to be very, very mindful about. So one would want everything, but at the same time, we have to be very careful that we don't intrude too much into the privacy of those who live on the islands.
Yeah, that makes sense. Thank you.
Just continuing that vein, so obviously indicators for each strategic objective is really important. And I say we are 2.5 years into this project, the plan, and you know the indicators were supposed to be formed with government agencies, local authorities, island communities. And it was going to be based on the SMART criteria. Now, there were certain things we knew before we started. So we knew some of the islands only had 60 or 70 individuals on there, and privacy was going to be important. But surely we should be far further down the road in fulfilling that obligation to have these indicators using SMART criteria when we're more than halfway through the plan. Why have we not got to the stage where that's in place?
But I think that's where what Francesco highlighted is so important, because it's, you know, identifying these challenges and trying to build that baseline picture as well so that we actually have something to monitor against. And that's where the different five projects, I hope you can understand it from what's set out in the work on that strategic objective, you can see the pieces of work that have been undertaken. None of these are quick or necessarily easy to do, but it's ensuring that we are continuing to progress that. And as I say, the data indicators framework and that project that's being taken forward, it's trying to see what existing indicators we can use to monitor the framework too, but it's ensuring we're getting that baseline data that will help us to do this and to do it effectively.
So when we have the 2023 plan, will these indicators to look at the progress on the strategic objectives be available to us?
Well, I think we've commissioned another National Islands Plan survey, which will help us build on that, which will hopefully be launching in the summer this year. I can't say it will necessarily be completed unless officials can give me that confirmation at the meeting today. But because I think the nature of some of these projects, that is ongoing, but I think we have been making progress when you look from last year to this year, and we will continue to make that progress and build on that data as we move forward.
OK, can I bring in Nicola?
Which has already outlined what we've previously focused on is gathering the baseline data, and that has been the focus of the last couple of years. Unfortunately, it has been very difficult, as you obviously appreciate. A lot of the data out there is split; it is not accurately split between the mainland and islands. However, in the coming year, as the Cabinet Secretary said, we're going to rerun the island survey, which will allow us to have more comparable data. We're also going to update the previous islands dashboard, which will give us further comparable data to use. This will be the first year that we're going to have two separate batches of data to be able to compare and contrast to see what the trends and changes have been.
Thank you very much. Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. I wonder if you could say a bit more about where island communities play a role in assessing the impact of what the island plan is achieving. And by that, I don't just mean the important quantitative data that you're talking about there, but the qualitative opinion. How do you measure that?
That is really important, and I think we want to make sure that we've got that voice featuring strongly as we move forward through the implementation of the plan and from the actions that we've set out there too. That's where the work, so we have a couple of different bodies to help us with the implementation of the plan and the monitoring of that. We'll have the Island Strategic Group, which the local authorities sit on, and I've actually got the next meeting of that coming up shortly. We also have the National Islands Plan Delivery Group as well, and that's where you really see that engagement. So there are a number of bodies represented on that. So as an example, we have HAI, Federation of Small Business, Scottish Islands Federation, the CalMAC Community Boards represented on that. As I mentioned earlier, we have representatives from the Young Islanders Network on that group as well. But that group, it's also been convened to help us look at issues as they've been emerging. So there have been meetings of that group to discuss the cost crisis, as an example. And so it's been really helpful in getting that feedback and having those conversations and, as you say, making sure that we have that voice feeding into the process. But I don't know if officials want to give more information in relation to particular the Islands Plan Delivery Group.
Okay, I'm happy just to say a few more words. The National Islands Plan Delivery Group is a key instrument, but not the only one. Mm-hmm. I think another thing to highlight is that we as an islands team are connected to the region with liaison officers for each local authority. So, for example, to use my own example, I'm the liaison officer for Shetland Islands. What that means is that actually this goes way beyond the local authority itself. Obviously, we develop strong relationships with the officials, with my counterpart, if you want, in the local authority. But actually, that allows us to really get a close connection to the communities in Shetland, for example, again, with my case. And I think that is something very important for the islands team, to really develop those relationships and assess, sometimes almost unofficially, how the communities are responding to the work that we're doing, how we can improve it, and how we can take it forward. So I think that's another aspect of the way we engage with the communities, which I think is an important one.
And if you're liaising with local authorities, I think you're also liaising with individual island communities, because you know what I'm going to say here, but for somebody, I'm not going to name the islands, but for somebody in certain islands, the local authority is not only distant, but they don't have much sympathy with it. So how do you ensure that you're liaising with specific islands and not just with local authorities, which are distant beasts?
Yeah.
I know which island you're referring to. Again, every island is different. Every local authority is different as well. So, you know, it's difficult to paint the picture for everybody. But I do think that throughout the years, we have engaged with so many organizations through the projects that have been awarded, through the processes that have been set up. Again, obviously, I can expand more on the Carbon Neutral Island project, but that's just one of the many projects. And the local authority is just one of the stakeholders, if you want, in the local authority territory, let's say. But also, and again, maybe I can speak more of my own case. I mean, there will be cases where local authorities can open doors to communities. Now, whether they all love each other happily, that's another issue. But obviously, they are on the ground. They know who the people are much better than me in Glasgow, you know. So I do think there needs to be that level also of trust with local authorities that have been developed. And then we have to work also very efficiently through them and arrive to the lowest of the islands in whatever local authority.
I don't see any of that to take away from the importance of the local authorities, but you know what I'm referring to, so thank you for that.
Thank you. Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning. Can I turn to island proofing now, or island community impact assessments? Does the annual report show that these assessments have led to a change in mindset and culture in public bodies?
I think they have been a really important tool to do exactly that, because what the island communities impact assessments do is put the onus on policy teams to consider island communities. I'm sure the team here with me today can go into more detail about their engagement, but they engage extensively, particularly across Scottish Government and other policy teams as well, ensuring that we're doing that and feeding in. Because as you can see from the National Islands Plan, I mean, our communities don't operate in silos. It crosses every single part of government, and there is that relevance there as well. It's also, we just want to highlight too that we have updated the guidance on islands community impact assessments, how they should be undertaken, provided more materials in relation to that, videos and more information as to how they should be undertaken. I think based on the feedback we'd received from that process, and the islands team obviously stand ready to work with any public authorities who are undertaking the impact assessments to ensure that they are taking the right things into consideration and using them as they should be used.
I mean, I think there's a concern that it might just be seen as a tick box exercise, and I can give an example of the National Care Service and Shetland's view of it, that it was just that, a tick box exercise.
Well, they certainly should not be, and it specifically says that within the guidance as well, that they should not be seen as a tick box exercise. But I think we do have examples of where islands community impact assessments have been used and policies have either been adjusted to reflect that. And I think one example of that is the definition of fuel poverty that we have as well. So it was on the back of an islands community impact assessment that had been undertaken that the definition of that was changed, obviously recognising the significant impact that there can be for island communities as well. So I certainly do not see them as a tick box exercise. As I say, it specifically states that in the guidance that they should not be. But the team engage extensively to ensure that the relevant authorities who should be undertaking these are doing them well and are considering the findings mm-hmm. of them too. But I would say that if there is disagreement in relation to that or about how that's been undertaken, the process for that is also set out in regulations from 2022 in the Islands Community Impact Assessment Regulations.
Yeah, just giving that example, I was meaning more that the government had treated it as a tick box exercise and perhaps not listening to what the islands were saying.
No, as I say, I mean, I've given that example there of how we've actually changed an area on the back of an islands community impact assessment. We have to publish those impact assessments as well. As I say, the process is there if there is disagreement as to the information that's there or how that's been undertaken too. But I mean, we do take the islands community impact assessments seriously. And if we determine or another public authority determines one shouldn't be undertaken, that information also has to be published as well. So it's aiming to be as transparent as possible and outlining how our island communities have been taken into consideration as we're developing various policies or different strategies.
Thank you.
Oh, sorry, Francesco.
Yes, I'm wondering whether I can just add two quick points on the ICA. You started the question by saying it's about island proofing, and I just want to go back to that because ICIA is a specific instrument to make island proofing a reality. And I think one example where that has happened very strongly was in developing the Island Cost Crisis Emergency Fund. I think the team, together obviously with Cabinet Secretary, I mean, it was very apparent that there were some likely significant negative effects, additional effects on island communities. That's exactly what ICA is all about. That's exactly what island proofing is all about. And the government was able to move very quickly to deliver on an Island Cost Crisis Emergency. We obviously know that, you know, that wasn't what would solve cost crisis, that would be magic silver bullet. But it was very well received by, again, the communities, by the local authorities, as an example, as a tangible example of moving fast in island proofing and delivering on the promises of the Island Scotland Act. And the last thing is, it may not be perfect, I mean, obviously, but even in my interaction with island communities or island governments from other regions, other countries, they actually always ask about ICIAs. So I do think that it may not be perfect, but actually by working within the islands team and with the communities and all the stakeholders to fine-tune it, to make it work even better, this is one of the several layers of island policy that actually is recognised also internationally. I just wanted to highlight that.
I think Erica would like to come in.
Thank you, Convener. I'm probably just going to reinforce some of the words there that you heard from Professor Sindico, but just to thank Ms. Wishart also for her question. ICIAs are a very busy area of work for my team. We have dedicated team members just working on that policy area, and they engage regularly on a daily basis with colleagues right across Scottish Government, but also beyond, in respect of the 71 relevant authorities within the Act. And they offer guidance and support, and they work very hard to make sure that islands are represented in the work that they're developing. So we take it very seriously indeed. And as Francesco said, internationally, many of our island partners are curious about our ICIA work and look at it as a best practice model. We recently did consult on the guidance that we'd originally published alongside the regulations and realised that actually they could be better and more user-friendly. So we've simplified those and made them much more accessible to people. And with regards to the NCS work, the National Care Service work, a full range of impact assessments were done, including the Island Communities Impact Assessment on the bill. And that was obviously in line with statutory duties and commitments. And those ICIAs or those impact assessments that were published were very specific to the provisions within the bill. So we're working with our colleagues to do more impact assessment work alongside their development of the policy and secondary legislation, etc. So we are, just to reassure Ms. Wishart, very committed to engaging with our colleagues across government and also with our colleagues in island communities to make sure that impact assessments are done correctly.
Just on a follow-up, Cabinet Secretary, so we've heard from Alistair Allen that there may be some difference between local authorities and what's actually happening on the ground. The guidance so far appears around ICIAs, it appears to be directed toward public bodies, and there's a lack of guidance available to how communities actually engage with impact assessments. Is that something you're trying to address?
Well, as Erica was just outlining there, I mean, we have, based on the feedback that we'd had, we've worked on that guidance and refreshed that in the course of last year as well. I mean, obviously the onus is on those relevant authorities that are published in the schedule. We have 71 authorities there who must undertake island communities impact assessment. So, of course, that's where the focus has been on how they undertake that work, ensuring that they do meaningfully engage with the people who are going to be impacted by those policies as well.
But that's currently public bodies. Is there any efforts to ensure that individuals within communities can actually engage with assessments on
I'm sure
a guidance
could
on how
probably
they do.
Give more information in relation to the consultation that they have to undertake, but of course we provide that guidance to public bodies because they're the ones who are legally obligated to undertake those assessments.
Okay,
but I don't know if you want more information in relation to that.
Yeah,
sorry,
I suppose
just on the consultation
it's just
point.
Back to, you know, we hear that local authorities have a role to play, absolutely, but making sure that it's community voices that are feeding in and those community voices know how to feed in is important. The guidance at the moment is lacking. That's the question. Is that something you're looking to address going forward?
So, again, happy also for other members of the team to jump in. I think there are at least two or three aspects to highlight here. One, in the context of an ICIA itself, island communities will be consulted through the measures that we have at our disposal, that being the National Islands Plan Delivery Group, the sometimes more informal channels that we mentioned before. But another point is, the second point is that when the whole process began, there was some confusion as to whether an ICIA could be triggered by island communities. And if you look at the regulations and the Act, that's not the case. So island communities impact assessments are for the 71 relevant authorities. So it's a public sector, let's say, duty. However, island communities can review the decision either not to carry out an ICIA or to review ICAs that have been carried out. So island communities do have that capacity. We do need to continue working with them, again, in the similar ways that I mentioned before, to further that capacity, to provide further clarity on how to engage with that. So I just wanted to add that.
OK, thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Thanks, Convener. I just wanted to explore a bit more on the ICIAs and kind of following on from both Beatrice Wishart's questions and the Convener's. And so kind of like a bit more explanation so I can understand and maybe we can understand. So in talking with island communities, my understanding is that the assessments are, well, they're saying to me that the assessments need to be reviewed, that bodies and directorates charged with undertaking them are the same people assessing whether the impacts have been mitigated sufficiently, and so they feel like the process is somewhat flawed. So it's good to hear from the conversation already that I get a sense that you're listening and taking on the learning, but what would you say in response to that, this kind of idea that it's the same bodies doing the assessments and then monitoring them, and where's that opportunity for communities to get real consideration?
I mean, I'm obviously happy to take any feedback in relation to that, because as you've highlighted, and I think hopefully as we've been able to highlight today as well, we've already reviewed the guidance based on feedback and how we undertake these, and obviously constantly trying to look to make improvements wherever we can. But yeah, Francesco.
Yeah, I don't want to reiterate what I said before, but in particular, the National Islands Plan Delivery Group does provide us with a forum quite representative across the island communities that can then filter this accountability, if you want, down to the island communities. But I do acknowledge that as much as we try to engage and do engage with island communities, in an ideal world, we would do even more of that. And island communities would have even more access to that accountability, that reviewing and so forth. But in the structures that we have at our disposal, the delivery group, the liaising with the local authorities, and going beyond local authorities, I do think that we are providing island communities with the voice that the Islands Act has promised them to have.
Just to take that a little bit further, so another thing that I understand in conversation with people around this is that the ICIAs are retrospective rather than proactive. And I'd like to hear a little bit, yes, I see your expression or face. I'd like to hear a little bit more about why they might think that that's the case. And because you talked earlier about there being some kind of confusion around how ICIAs are used or triggered.
I think, speaking from our own example and from the example I'd highlighted earlier, and the team maybe I want to come in with more examples on the back of that as well. I mean, we very much use them in the development of policies and strategies. I mean, I've highlighted one particular example where an assessment was taken and we made a change. So I think that's very much how I view them, in the same way that we have to undertake when we're looking at other policies, business regulatory impact assessments, considering all that information, showing how that's factored into the decision making. But I don't know if Francesco or anyone else from the team would want to add any information to that.
I'll just add to that. I mean, do you think we understand why, how could it be that people are thinking that they are retrospective rather than proactive? Maybe there's some communication issue there.
Can I just bring in Erica? Erica's signaled she'd like to respond.
Thank you. Again, I don't wish to reiterate much of what Francesco and the Cabinet Secretary have already contributed. But I think the legislation is the legislation, and we need to ensure that we deliver it as it's written. And so, to a degree, the translation of the legislation into practice is restricted as set out in the regulations. But in terms of the question there from Spotus about whether it's retrospective or reactive, I'm sorry if that's the impression that communities are coming away with. They are most definitely intended to be done at the beginning of the process, as the guidance sets out. So really just a commitment to the committee on behalf of Ms. Goujon that we, as we've said, there's always more we can do. So we will take this away and think about how we can make sure that the messaging around ICIAs is clearer and more easily understood for communities, for the people that the regulations are meant to benefit most.
Thanks for that, Erica. I'm just kind of That's really helpful and I think hopefully reassuring. And again, I really do hear that this is somewhat of an iterative process. That you are listening. But I just want to come back to the piece around communities and public bodies and really ensuring that communities get their voices heard. And how can we make sure that the ICIAs are the mechanism that the islanders can use? So an example that's been given to me is the ICIA being used to stop Haiyao, the ATAC centralisation, or, for example, the Malan Iona situation with ferry capacity. So, you know, how can we make sure that the ICIAs work and that communities really actually, you know, because certainly those two issues have kind of really, I think they've been trying to raise them for quite a long time, and you would think that the assessments would flag that up and help us get more proactive with them.
I think if there's any particular issues there, I'm more than happy to follow that up with you after the committee today or to follow that up with the committee directly. I mean, obviously, ICIAs are a mechanism that we must use in developing policies, but they are not the only mechanism by which we engage with communities. I think we've highlighted some of the examples there, whether that's through the National Islands Plan Delivery Group. We have the strategic group where we engage with councils, but there is also the engagement that Francesco talked about as well with various different island stakeholders. So I wouldn't want anybody to think that that is the only mechanism by which they can make their views known on a policy, because obviously we want to consult and engage with communities as much as we possibly can in the course of policy development. So while some of these bodies have a particular role, we have informal engagement with our stakeholders as well and with communities. So that's by no means the only mechanism by which they can have a say or have an influence.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
I've got three supplementaries here before I bring Erica back in. So briefly, Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Convener. Possibly, this is maybe aimed at yourself, Francesco, because this is possibly more granular. But am I not right in thinking that each island has got a local steering group that employs a community development officer directly in the local anchor organisation, and that some of the community development officers are actually young islanders who have been able to return home to work on specific projects? Is that not the case?
That is correct. Obviously, we're talking about the Carbon Neutral Islands project here. So there are six islands that have been included in the CNI project. On each island, there's a bottom-up structure. There's a governance structure that allows a very strong island voice to direct the journey of carbon neutrality in that project. And the key players are very much an island steering group, composed of, depending on the island in different ways, of people representing all different socioeconomic sectors, parts of society on that specific island. That steering group has identified a local anchor organization that in the past year and in this year is receiving funding from the Carbon Neutral Island Project to hire one community development officer. And you're absolutely right. There are at least three islands where the CDO that has been recruited is a young islander who was doing their studies on the mainland, and thanks to the CNI project, they were able to go back to their own island and drive carbon neutrality on their island, hence following their passion, but also deploying the skills that they have developed on their own island.
So there is good, strong local engagement when you've got local steering groups who are helping to develop these things.
Absolutely. And one thing I need to make very clear, we from the Carbon Neutral Island Project, we from the island team, have not in any way steered the steering group, meaning it's to them. It's up for them to understand what works better in the context of Isla, in the context of Barra, in the context of Hoi. Again, just to repeat the point, I mean, we do not know as well as they do the reality on the ground. So for the CNI project, the steering group decides how it's structured, how it operates, and so forth.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Alistair Allen.
Thank you, Convener. Clearly, the ICIAs have made a, no pun intended, but a big impact, and they've raised expectations in a way about the kind of decisions that will be subjected to that assessment. One of the questions I sometimes get asked is which organisations or which agencies or which bodies are required to consider going down this route. I just wondered if you can say a bit there about which are and which aren't, because I think that's sometimes the questions we get asked locally.
Yeah, that's fine. I mean, there is a list of bodies that are the bodies that are expected to undertake Island Communities Impacts Assessment are set out in the schedule. So we have 71 bodies that are listed there. I'd be happy to send that information to the committee if you'd find that helpful.
I suppose what I'm driving at is, are you satisfied that list is complete enough, given the variety of agencies that are involved in delivering policy in an island setting, or is that something that you keep under review? Or?
Sorry, you don't need to operate your mic. The operator will press the button.
Oh, okay. Great. Sorry, I apologise. So we have these 71. The way we see it is that this is... When I say constantly under review, I don't want to raise any expectations here. But I do think that when you are working with island communities, islands, you need to be aware that things may change. And hence, we do need to look at it. But I do want to highlight a further aspect of island communities' impact assessment, and even of the wider work that we do. When an ICIA is required, it's often another team, say, in government, another area of government that will carry out the ICIA. And this is similar to many of the areas of competence that one may think fall under the islands team, be it transport, be it digital connectivity, be it you name it. We have a huge role in working closely with other areas of government to encourage, to strengthen, to push, to promote the interest of islands and islands communities from a policy area and so forth. So even with ICIA, our role is so much with the island communities, but actually there's a lot of role within these buildings, if you want. And a lot of the work that we do and that we put a lot of effort in is to almost, I don't know whether the right word, but to educate our own colleagues about ICIAs, how to make it better, and really to island-proof our own policies. And I think that's, again, the power of ICAs. There's a power externally, because at the end of the day, done well, it will benefit island communities. But there's also a power internally, because, again, if we speak more about it, if people are more aware of it within our own buildings, our own government, then the island communities will benefit from that.
Thank you.
Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener. Just on that point of ICIAs being done well, but what if communities think or they disagree with the conclusions? How is there any recourse for them, for communities?
There's a process for that which is set out in the regulations.
Right. Thank you.
Thank you. Erica.
Thank you, Convener. I feel like I'm spending most of the morning just reiterating what's already been said, so apologies to the committee. As I said, there is always more we can do in terms of engaging communities, and we will take that away as a strong message from today's session. I think I really just wanted to reinforce the point that island communities impact assessments are not meant to be a tool to block things happening, but to be an aid to support better policy development. So that's really very much the position from which we come. I think it's also just worth maybe mentioning that all of the Scottish Government's Island Communities Impact Assessments are published on our website, so anybody is able to take a look at those. The other point I wanted just to bring in was around the schedule that we just mentioned there of the 71 relevant authorities. That list, as far as I understand it, and we can write to committee just to confirm this, so hope I'm right, but that list can be amended at the discretion of ministers, and island communities have already indicated a desire to expand this list. And so that's one thing that we will be engaging with them on. Thank you.
Yeah, that is correct. It's set out in the Act that we can change that list or add or amend it by regulations.
Thank you. That's helpful. We're now going to move on to Carbon Neutral Islands Project. A question from Rhoda Grant.
Thank you, Convener. Can I ask about progress on the project and also what lessons have been learned that can be rolled out to other islands, obviously?
I will give a brief outline. I know Francesco will be desperate to come in as he's the project lead on carbon neutral islands. So you'll be aware that in January this year, we published a progress update report as to where we are in relation to that. Francesco has already touched on the community development officers that we have working within each of the communities. The carbon audits, the in-depth carbon audits have been undertaken. And I believe that the climate change action plans for each of those areas have now been completed, but they're still to be published, and that's where we are at the moment. But I'll hand over to Francesco, who can provide some more of the detail.
Thank you very much. Thank you for the question. I will try to keep it brief, but there could be a lot I can say about it. First part is about progress so far. The second part about the lessons learned. So when it comes to progress so far, as Cabinet Secretary anticipated, the CNI project supported, and I strengthened support, it didn't carry out, it supported in-depth carbon audits on each of the six islands. These audits have been complex, have been difficult to undertake, but they have provided a granular level of data, exactly what we were saying before, that wasn't there before. And I can expand on that in just a second. The whole purpose of having the audit was to not so much to dictate which actions to take by the community. Quite the opposite. Again, this is a community-led project. But the goal of the carbon audits was to give data, evidence, information to, again, the structure I mentioned before, the steering group, the CDOs, the local anchor organizations, to inform their conversation. And that conversation, that engagement, again, as anticipated, has led to the six community climate change action plans that will soon be published. A word on these action plans, just to ensure that once you see them, you understand what you have in front of you. These are not plans like the ones that we're used to seeing, full of references to previous plans, to policy documents, and so forth. This is written by the island community. This will highlight the priorities, the interests, the aspirations, sometimes the dreams of the island communities as represented by steering group, CDO, local anchor organization through the engagement that has happened throughout the year. There's going to be a summary of the audits in the different sectors and then very specific information about key actions, key areas that I'm happy to expand very briefly if you want in just a second for each island. What happens now is very important, because what you'll have in a few weeks, hopefully, are six glossy, nice, hopefully nicely laid out documents that you will all enjoy. You can put them in your library or in your computer. But let's be honest, especially island communities have seen way too many of those kind of documents. Action needs to happen now. So two things will happen this year. We do have 1 million capital spending allocated to the CNI project. 1 million doesn't do anything when it comes to carbon neutrality. However, it can provide some funding for some quick win-wins that will provide visibility to the CNI project on the island and will provide that boost of confidence to the CDOs, to the steering groups, and so forth. The second thing that will happen is thinking a bit more long-term. And we will be supporting, with key delivery partners, the development of climate change investment strategies. And by that, we mean two things. One, we'll have this plan, we'll have the aspirations, the interest of the island communities. We need to cost them. We need to see how much would these projects that they would like to take, how much would they actually cost? Are they feasible? Are they not? But more importantly, is how can we promote finance? How can we drive finance towards net zero, not just beyond this financial year, but between now, 2040, and even further, so that carbon neutrality becomes a reality? And not just for the sake of carbon neutrality, but as in the spirit of the CNI project, to promote islands that are more resilient, more sustainable, and attractive places to stay and move to. So that's a very important strand of work that we're going to start this year to really focus on the investment strategy that is going to happen. Very briefly on the lessons that we have learned until now. Audits. The audits were about energy, about transport, about waste, about land-related emissions, about mostly those, but the main sectors that Scotland as a whole also looks at. Some of these audits have been done with a very strong input from the community. I will not repeat what the community means here. And that was also from the analysis that has been done by the delivery partners, in particular by Community Energy Scotland, a success. So the fact that the community, for example, through household surveys, was really providing the input that allowed the audits to tell you the real story of Yale, the real story of Islay, and not national databases that can be a bit askew. So that was a really, really good practice. However, it's time-consuming, and it does require that level of confidence, trust, and support on the specific island. The challenges in the audit were more related to two things. One, in those more technical areas, for example, land-related emissions, or an initial attempt to better understand the marine ecosystems and how the marine ecosystems have an impact on climate change, be it for good or for bad, those were very technical matters that have been, if you want, given out to external consultants. The two problems there were that, in particular, blue carbon is a very, very novel area, even of science, and it was difficult to get to very clear messages, to very clear data. So that's an area where, and you'll hear this often over the next year of Carbon Neutral Island Project, ground truthing is needed. We need to not go back and redo the whole thing, clearly not, but we do need to get a much better picture, sounder science. And I think this will be, this should not be seen as a negative, as a downside of the CNI project. Actually, this is good for Scotland as a whole, because blue carbon is very much a baby, if you want. It's an incipient for all of Scotland. So we can use the CNI project ground truthing to fine-tune the methodologies, fine-tune the information that will then be useful for all of our coastal waters and everything. The other thing is the engagement between external consultants and the communities. Sometimes it works well, sometimes not so much, and that's where that level of trust, confidence, support needs to happen also when it's not just the CNI team, but also people that are brought from the outside. I apologise, Chair, and I'm happy to expand on more points if you want.
No apologies needed. That's very interesting. Rhoda, have you any?
Yes, yeah, I've got a couple more questions. You talk about funding and how we're going to get the funding in. Is the Islands Programme providing any funding for that? Can the National Islands Plan play a role in helping them? And I suppose I'm kind of concerned because as a country we need to reach net zero. Those are small islands. And you seem to indicate, yes, we can get to grips with how much carbon is there. But I wasn't so confident when you talked about the plans that were coming out from islands. You talked about dreams, you talked about funding, you talked about cost. If we can't do it on this, what is a tiny scale compared to the rest of Scotland, you know, what hope of reaching the greater goals for Scotland becoming carbon neutral?
Mm-hmm. Happy to expand on that very briefly. This year, we will be examining more closely what the, as you also mentioned, these dreams, aspirations, if you want to call them like that, if all of them were complied with, if all of them were met, what big of a difference would it make from a net zero perspective, from a carbon neutrality perspective? And I won't go into the difference between net zero and carbon neutrality, but that is a discussion we will be having this year, I think. There is a big challenge because once we get the numbers right, especially for land-related emissions, and again, both Cabinet Secretary and myself were in Shetland and we heard this firsthand, if we're only looking at net zero in the context of, with all the respect, in the context of bigger Scotland and climate change, these small islands, even if we were to bring all of Yale to net zero, all of RASi to net zero, or even better, carbon neutrality, in the context of the bigger picture of Scotland, the world, that will not have a huge impact when it comes to climate change. However, you're absolutely right that islands are there, and the CNI project there is to show that we can do it, that we can provide that expertise, but also those jobs and skills that can then potentially be replicated elsewhere. What I want to say is really the following, is that if the only way to get to net zero is by focusing only on one of those aspects, say again, land-related emissions, but actually that goes against the will of the community on that specific island, if it just makes the islands even more costly, more difficult to provide housing, more everything, then that is not, at least in my opinion, the single way forward. We need to find a balanced approach where all the aspects of the audit, be it energy, be it transport, be it, are looked at together. Finance-wise, the only thing I will say here is that whilst there is dedicated support for the CNI project that is separate to the islands program, in order to deliver, even on a small island like RASi, say, in terms of population, you will need more finance. And that's where the work of myself, of the team that leads on the CNI project, is a bit like I said with ICA, is within these corridors as well, with working with other colleagues in government. And we had good examples last year working with our adaptation colleagues who have provided some financial support, and we want to work more in that direction. So just to highlight that it's not just the CNI, it's not just the Islands Programme, it's a bigger Scottish Government effort when it comes to...
Yeah, I was just going to come in on that, because I know that there's, well, there has been the £1 million allocation there, just as Francesco was saying towards the end of his comments there, that's by no means the only investment that is being made. I think when you look at other parts, well, obviously we have for the Islands Programme, but I mean, there is spend that will impact this across all other parts of government too, not to mention the Islands Growth Deal as well, and how that can help contribute.
Can I just, I suppose, drill down to just one small aspect of all of this? Fuel poverty, huge in our islands. These small islands would be a really good test bed to test out government policy on fuel poverty. So I'm specifically talking about boiler replacement, insulation. I mean, has there work been done on that that we can quickly roll out? That speaks to me of changes to national government policy rather than something that would be specific to those wee islands. But if we could test it in those wee islands, it would be a win-win to roll it out to other islands, because fuel poverty is huge.
Oh, I know it's a massive issue, and that was a subject of conversations that I had in Shetland last week, and trying to look at innovative ways of how we can try and address some of the issues that we're facing. I think when you look at our islands, the fact that they are at the forefront of innovation, and I think when you look at the energy that is produced and that they're responsible for contributing, yet it's our islands that suffer the greatest rates of fuel poverty. Of course, these issues are... they are complex because we don't have all the levers to necessarily fix that. But I think this project allows us to look at within these communities. I mean, obviously, we're focusing on carbon neutrality, but how we can try and best tackle and address that as well. And no doubt you'll be aware of some of the other schemes that we have there and the particular focus on islands that are within those two in relation to fuel poverty.
But maybe if I can just let me just 30 seconds.
Unfortunately, members, we've got about 12 questions to go, which gives us about 2 minutes for a question and answer. We're going to try to keep on going. Apologies. I've got Ariane would like to come in, and Nicola also would like to comment.
Thanks very much, convener. I think that's been a really helpful line of questioning from Rhoda Grant to understand that. I just wanted to understand the 1 million kind of like catalysing, confidence-bringing amount. How will that be divided between the six islands? Is it, you know, that they have to apply, or is it going to be split evenly? What's the approach there?
We have decided to split it evenly. For this first year, we'll see what happens next year, but the level of, again, trust, confidence, support within the communities is such. We had a very important get-together at the end of March in RASi in person, all of us there, really gelled, if you want. And so in principle, it's the same for everybody. Obviously, we will need to ask them to put forward some application projects, but very also learning from the past, not too time consuming, Obviously, we'll scrutinise them. We will give a timeline whereby, say, if this will never happen, but if an island doesn't have projects, then obviously we won't just lose the money. We will pass on the money in to other islands in the best possible way that we can think of. But the idea is to split them evenly this time.
And then very just quickly, that you've talked a lot about the CDOs. They seem to be really crucial people in making sure these plans get taken forward. And we're looking at this happening until 2040. That's the ambition. Do we have a commitment on those CDOs being resourced ongoing through the whole time of the project?
I mean, in relation to that, I think we need to see how the project continues and develops. But, I mean, you're absolutely right in terms of the critical role that they have been playing so far. Because I think what, and coming back to the point that Francesco made earlier, I think what's been brilliant about the project is seeing young people returning to the islands, you know, and returning from studying on the mainland and going back to their communities and having that position there to enable them to do that. Because they are embedded there, they know that, and they are in the best position then to try and build that community engagement and involvement with the plan.
Thank you.
I'm going to bring in Nicola.
I just wanted to address Ms Grant's point directly about the relationship between the Islands Programme, the National Islands Plan and the Carbon Neutral Islands Project, and just highlight that an intrinsic pillar of the National Islands Plan is it's to be green. So very much supports the Carbon Neutral Islands, which is a key project, obviously, to progress this element of it. And secondly, I just wanted to highlight that one of the Islands Programme projects that have been announced, the Garrison House Regeneration Scheme on Cumbrae, is also going to be jointly funded by the Islands Programme and the Carbon Neutral Islands. So it's a really good example of collaborative working and how the projects that are in the Islands Programme will form a pipeline to support the likes of the CNI project.
Thank you very much. And very, very briefly, we know that you don't suddenly get a toolbox of policies that they're built up and they come along at different stages. When you develop a policy that works on an island, is that knowledge transferred to other islands that are not in the CNI group? So are we seeing that the quick hit, the policies that we know are proven to work are actually rolled out across all our islands, and is there funding there to support that rollout?
That is a key part of the project, is ensuring that replicability across other islands. Yeah, sorry, the word's not coming to me. But to ensure that we can roll out our learning. So I think while we very much have six islands as part of this project, we want to make sure that we're rolling out that learning just across Scotland, but as well as internationally too.
OK, thank you very much. We're now going to move on to addressing depopulation, and I've got a question from Christine Graham.
Yes, thank you very much. Very, very interesting evidence. We talk about the islands, but my understanding is there are 93 populated islands in Scotland. Huge diversity. Diversity in perhaps just single figures population, large populations, demographics very different, and distance from mainland and so on. So I was interested in the action of steering groups on islands, because grassroots input with all that diversity. So I wanted to ask you if you could give me an example from an island with a very small population. I don't know if you can name it, might be wrong to do it. A small population, what proposals they put forward which were actually not feasible, and what you were ever the response would be to, what response there was to that. Because there's diplomacy involved here as well, I would imagine. And an example from a large populated island where they came forward with proposals, this is to sustain their population and even increase it, because that's what this is really about. And what came from that?
If I can just start off with that. So I think one of the key consultations that we've done in recent times and the engagement that we've undertaken was in relation to the Islands Bond, where there was extensive engagement and consultation with island communities. So through that, there was quite clear feelings put across about the Islands Bond itself, but also, what really came through that were some really helpful and positive suggestions as to how we could try and tackle depopulation or help retain populations within different island communities. So I think that was a really positive part of that process, was we're taking these ideas and these suggestions, and we've taken those and developed practical policy tests to try and see if those are effective. In relation to, you were asking for an example that wasn't taken on board. I'd have to turn to officials for that. I don't know what examples in particular there would be, but I would say that we definitely had some really good and positive suggestions that we've listened to and we've tried to implement on the back of that consultation.
This because, I mean, I do envy the task that you have with such a diversity. And, of course, the target, I imagine, is to sustain our islands and to increase populations as best it can. So it would be really handy for me if you give me an example of an island that, say, population's under threat, and you want to sustain the population and increase it. What proposals came from that community, and you know what the response was to it? And an island, perhaps, that doesn't need so much help, Skye, let's say, or something that's maybe buzzing along happily. I don't know. And what proposals came, and what the response to that was. It gives me an idea of how effective the grassroots are, and how realistic, because I think one of the important things you said was building confidence in some of the islands, that they could do something, but you'd have to temper that with realism and finance.
I mean, I think there's been one in particular, I'm sure officials will correct me if I'm wrong or come in with more information, in the Western Isles about an island skills and employment repopulation pilot that's been taken forwards with £250,000 of funding as a result of some of that engagement. But I don't know if Nicola or Cameron would want to come in with more information.
Cameron would like to come in. Cameron? The other Cameron. No, well, I can't even. So far away, I can't even see if your lips are moving, Cameron, unfortunately.
Yeah, because Cameron engaged extensively in that work and was and undertook the consultation.
Has he got his microphone on?
Maybe the connection.
Yes.
No, I'm a.
Oh, well.
We're not getting anything. Christine. Oh, Francesca.
Just very briefly, even if it's from an energy perspective, but what we have experienced in the community engagement with the CNI project was that on some islands, these are the larger islands, let's say, there's a lot of interest in, let's call it like this, reaping benefits in order also to attract population, increase the resilience and sustainability of the island from our offshore, for example, wind developments. That's where you called it diplomacy, let's say. That's where we need to be very open and front with the community, saying this is not just in our hands. Yes. This is a wider UK government matter. So that's one of the examples that I can share with you, where there is that conversation ongoing. On the smaller islands, there have been some projects that are very much more granular, if you want, that sometimes can be supported even solely by the islands team through the islands programme, that in some cases can bring back maybe a relatively small number of peoples, but that can have that trickle effect. And also, on the smallest islands, sometimes you really just need a family. Mm-hmm. And that allows the school to remain open. And that's a trickling effect.
Is that as far down as you go? I mean, I think there's an island with one person on it, so you wouldn't, I take it they're not involved in this, or are they? I mean, what is there a sort of cut-off point where you say, this is the population below which we will not be engaging?
No.
So even an island with one person.
I can think of Rona has two. They were looking for two other people. And
good.
They are an island. They are part of Scotland.
No, it's good to hear. I'm
speaking
of stuff.
Maybe out of turn here, but no. If we're the islands team, we're the team for all the islands.
Yeah. Perhaps convener, if David can't speak, we could get some written. Cameron, is it? Can't.
Yeah.
We could get some reply from him at some point.
I'm sure if
I'd be happy to send you more information on the policy test if that's against some of the other projects.
I just want some examples. Tangible.
Yeah, there's that one in the Western Isles that I mentioned, but I mean, some other projects were undertaken where we know, for example, childcare can be an issue. That's one that we're taking forward on Mull and a childcare pilot there. But again, I can write to the committee with more information on these.
That's good. That's what I want to know.
That would be helpful. Thank you very much. Rachel Hamilton.
Cabinet Secretary, the HPM. MA policy has been likened to the Second Highland Clearance. How does this work with the National Islands Plan for combating and halting population decline?
I mean, no doubt you'll be aware, and members of the committee will be aware, that we've undertaken a consultation in relation to the HPMA process, and we'll be analysing the results of that as well. We talked earlier about island community impact assessments. A partial one was undertaken for that, but of course, we've got to make sure that we're taking into account these other impacts, of course, and we will be doing that through the processes that we have specified, as well as undertaking our own engagement throughout that. Throughout that as well. I mean, I was in Shetland last week meeting with people in the industries who to hear their views on that process and potential impacts of that, and to listen to people's concerns. And that's essentially what we've got to do. And we've also got to ensure that we're listening through that consultation exercise, and that we do give that full analysis of the consultation responses that we've received before setting out next steps.
Yeah, I did have, shared a response from Shetlanders over HPMAs. I wonder if you can share with the committee some of the issues that they were raising with you around the increasing the protected areas by 10%.
I mean, the concerns, I think the committee members will be well aware of. I know we've had a number of debates in relation to that, recently. Beatrice Wisher, I know, had a members' debate in relation to that and outlined the concerns of her constituents with that process as well. So again, we are listening to that, because of course we've got to take into account and consideration the National Islands Plan's objectives that we have here about the importance of populations, and as well as all the other strategic objectives that we have set out there too.
Okay, and can you clarify whether any port development projects have been affected because cancelled or delayed because of the increasing costs of the two Ferguson Marine ferries?
I don't have that information to hand, and I don't know if that's the case, but I'm more than happy to follow up with that.
Okay. I was interested also to know whether if there are any conflicting policies within your own portfolio, Cabinet Secretary, that are likely to have an effect on the delivery of the National Islands Plan.
We would aim for there not to be conflicting policies within that. I mean, obviously, between agriculture, fisheries, land reform and forestry sitting within the one portfolio, and no doubt you'll be aware of the various pieces of legislation that we have coming forward within these areas too. Of course, we've got to ensure that these are aligned and these are working for our island communities.
Okay. Do you want me to skip to my last question?
Just on that, has there been any projects that have been identified through the island plan that would be paused to wait to the outcome of the blanket 10% HPMAs, which may then mean that some harbour improvements or investment in fishing boats or whatever might come to nothing, because in 2 years' time, these island communities are not going to be able to fish the areas around the islands? Has there been any consideration of projects being paused, waiting for the outcome of the consultation?
Okay, we've had the consultation. We need to analyse and go through that process and then set out our next steps from there. But I think you can see from what we've published within the National Islands Plan in relation to the commitments that we've set out and covering the 13 strategic objectives, that work is continuing and work is ongoing.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to move on to Rhoda and then Beatrice, and I'll bring you back in for your question. Rhoda.
Just a couple of very quick questions about depopulation. Ferries are obviously a huge impact on depopulation. I think Kevin Stewart was told that the impact of what's happening with the ferries just now is worse than the impact of COVID on the economy of the islands, which is pretty horrendous. So I wonder what you and your role can do, especially when the Scottish Government has policies for dealing with depopulation, what can be done to stop that happening? And I suppose, secondary to that, the impact on Gaelic of depopulation, because what we've got is young native Gaelic speakers and families leaving the islands. And while we can try and bring new people in, they don't speak Gaelic. So within a generation, we could lose the whole language just because of depopulation and losing native speakers. And I'm not saying we shouldn't be increasing people coming in and encouraging people in, but we need to keep our own.
Absolutely, and I think that's critical, and we are absolutely committed to that as well. And I think you'll notice throughout the plan there and the implementation route map, the actions that are set out and that are currently underway and ongoing in relation to ensuring that we are enabling that going forward. And we do want to strengthen that and ensure that Gaelic, I mean, it's part of our cultural heritage, and we want to ensure that there will be continue to be a place for that going forward. And there have been a number of various ministerial groups in relation to that, that there have been a ministerial group in relation to and a task force Gaelic in the economy, and recognising that where Gaelic features, and whether that's housing, infrastructure and all the various policies that we have, and you can see that throughout the plan there. In relation to ferries and housing, I mean, when I'm going out and visiting island communities myself, it is the basic infrastructure which is always raised as a critical issue. That's where my work across government is really important in relation to that. You'll be aware that the Minister for Transport re-established the Islands Transport Forum, which now features as part of our island strategic group, and where we have the key bodies around the table to ensure that we are getting that cross-cutting engagement. And in relation to housing as well, again, that's a really important issue. And of course, I work closely with my colleague, the housing minister, in relation to the development of the Remote Rural and Island Housing Action Plan as well, which will be critical in trying to address some of those challenges.
Thank you. I've got a supplementary from Beatrice.
Thanks, Convener. I was just on the back of Rhoda's questions about transport and housing, because you can't speak about depopulation in islands without those two issues. Interesting, in housing in the CPG on space economy last night, housing was referenced in for rural areas, not necessarily island areas, but it is an issue in Shetland as well. But on transport, the long-term impact of, at the moment, there's a situation where people can't make bookings to get on the external ferry. You're probably aware of that. But the long-term impact is on islanders' confidence, and you have people saying that they can no longer live on the islands because they can't get away. So it's understanding, does government understand how serious the issue is with people can't get a booking to get to the mainland to carry out just normal family and business, their normal duties? With the booking system not being open, only open until the 30th of September, people can't make onward plans. And just to demonstrate how severe the issue is, I launched a questionnaire, an online survey on Monday, and within 24 hours I'd had 200 responses. So it's a big issue at the moment. So it's an understanding from government just how critical getting transport right is.
Absolutely, and I heard that message loud and clear when I was visiting Shetland last week as well, which is why, again, I follow that up with my colleagues, in this case with the Minister for Transport, to highlight that as well. Because you're absolutely right, the transport is important, having the housing availability is important as well, which is why this cross-government work that's happening is vital in trying to resolve some of these issues.
Thank you.
Okay, Beatrice, would you like to continue with looking at how the Scottish Government works with local authorities and the UK Government?
The report demonstrates the importance of local authorities to the delivery of the island's plan. So is the Scottish Government confident that island councils have enough money to meet the aspirations of the National Islands Plan? I mean, bearing in mind that some budgets have been cut quite significantly in real terms.
I think that we would all ideally want to be in a position where we have more resources at our disposal. I mean, I've been at this committee a number of times in relation to my own budget. And of course, we can always do more if we have more funding available to us. But I think in the last settlement, there was an increase of around £800 million to local authorities, which was a 3% real terms increase. There's also a special islands needs assessment as part of that as well, recognising the particular situation of our island authorities, where they get an extra uplift as part of that as well.
Thank you.
Jim Fairley.
Thank you, Convener. I know we've got the island's growth deal and the Argyllan Butte rural growth deal and the Ayrshire growth deal, and there's probably had some intersection there with the National Islands Plan. But I'm interested, can you tell me, can you tell the committee what recent communications you've had with the UK government regarding their proposed rural visa pilot?
Yes, in relation to that, well, first of all, to say that's been a really positive piece of work that we've developed and taken forward, and really had close engagement with various stakeholders and local authorities in development of that. And it was done on the back of the then Home Secretary, Sajid Javid, who said he was willing to consider a policy proposal like that. So we took that work forward. We wrote to the UK government in September last year, both myself and Neil Gray, who was the minister leading on migration at that point. But as yet, we haven't had any response to that. But what I would say is we have had extensive engagement with both the UK and the UK Parliament and the Welsh Parliament themselves, with the committees. We've also engaged with other committees within the Scottish Parliament as well. The Migration Advisory Committee actually welcomed the proposal as well and said that it seemed like a very sensible way forward. So it is frustrating we haven't had that direct feedback or engagement from the UK government in relation to that. But other than that, all other engagement has been really positive and the pilot has been widely welcomed.
So continue. When did you write to the UK government?
That was in September last year.
September last year, and you haven't had any response?
No.
Right. OK. Thank you, Convener.
OK. Karen Adam.
Thank you, Convener. And just a sub to that, it was just, do we have any update on the UK government minister coming to committee? Did we get a response?
I don't think that's the question for just now.
Oh, sorry, it was just on the back because we mentioned
okay.
The UK government minister.
Would you like to ask your question?
Oh, sorry. Well, that was a question.
Well, we've got very little time.
So that was a supplementary to that one before my question 13, because I've just been told we've run out of time for me to ask question 13 and just to ask for a written answer.
But no,
as well.
Just my mistake. Can you just keep your question brief? But if we need to expand it, what we'll do, we'll make sure we write to the Cabinet Secretary. It was just be very aware of the time. But if you'd like to ask your question, okay. if we need more time, we'll ask for a written response.
Okay, thank you. Good morning. So I'd like to ask how does the annual report show that the National Islands Plan and the Islands team are influencing decisions that are made by Scottish Government directorates?
I would say that one thing that's been great throughout this process is actually having the Islands team, and you know, in my opening remarks, really just wanted to thank them for the work that they do, because I think having an Islands team and the officials that we do have has been really critical in ensuring that we have that Islands representation across all parts of government. And I think, you know, we talked a bit about that and quite extensively talked about the extensive engagement that there is in relation to the Islands community impact assessments as well. But I mean, as an example of that, they're obviously heavily involved in the population work that we have as well. There's the Ministerial Population Task Force as well, which draws in other parts of government. So yeah, the work in that sense is really extensive.
That's good. Thank you.
Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you.
Oh, beg your pardon, I've got a supplementary from Alistair Allen.
I was just going to say that it wasn't appropriate for Calm to ask, I would ask the same question, but that was all the point I was making.
No, I thought you had a supplementary in question 13.
Really, no. I think we're running out of time, to be honest. I think, I tell a lie. Yep. If we have got time. It was really just about the annual report not just the annual report, but more generally, the ability, I think you've touched on it, the ability to influence other directorates of government when it comes to Ireland's policy. Obviously, you can't change, you've indicated you cannot change everything in Ireland yourselves as a directorate. And you've mentioned that the Ireland impact assessments may be something that can change the culture within government. But I just want to know what's the progress on changing that culture more broadly across government?
I think, well, the officials within the Islands team have been involved in this process for longer than I have, so they'll probably be able to give a better indication as to how that process has been. But I think it's been really, really critical having the team, because you can see from the objectives that we've set out here, obviously it covers every single part of government, which of course I'm not responsible for, but I think I see it as my role for having that cross-government, making sure that our Islands communities' voices and concerns are represented with within each of these areas where these other policy decisions are being taken. But I'll hand over to Frank.
I think progress is happening because often people come to us rather than us to them. And I've been now in post for 2 years at Secondi, and I've seen it increasing over the last 2 years. I see that as progress.
Okay, just before we move on to the very last question, can you very briefly set out how the Argyll and Bute Rural Growth Deal and the Ayrshire Growth Deal intersect or interact with the National Islands Plan?
Yeah, I would say that with the growth deals that we set out, and I would include the island's growth deal within that as well, I think they dovetail quite well with the objectives that we have set out there. I think focusing on some of these deals, there's the low carbon focus about sustainable, thriving communities. So I think that there is, of course, good crossover in relation to the objectives that we have set out and what the growth deals are looking to achieve.
OK, thank you. Rachel Hamilton.
Cabinet Secretary, what is the total spend on administration and salaries, including external consultants for those involved in the National Islands Plan, and how many staff does this fund? And on the basis that few milestones have been met on significant policy aims, such as connectivity or depopulation, can you demonstrate this is value for money?
I think we are demonstrating that, because I would categorically refute that little progress has been made given the 13 strategic objectives and I think the over 100 commitments that we have set out there as well. I don't think that's fair to all the teams that are doing work in these various different areas. In relation to the total spend, numbers of staff, of course, I don't have those figures to hand, but I'm happy to supply
that. I think that is also unfair to state that, because the papers that we have say, for example, that 3 out of the 9 milestones for meeting, you know, depopulation issues have been met, and in terms of connectivity, digital connectivity, according to what I've got in front of me, none of those have been met. So can you see why I'm asking this question?
But that's what I would ask. I mean, I cannot see how, from reading the plan, reading the implementation route map, how you can come to that view, because it's also recognising, as I was saying at the start of the committee, this isn't a case of ticking off commitments and we've solved one and move on to the next, because a lot of these programmes are ongoing and problems we can't solve overnight, as well as bearing in mind the significant periods of challenges that we faced. We've had Brexit, we've had a pandemic, which I said at the start meant that that focus had to quite rightly be pivoted towards dealing with that response. So I think to frame it in that way, I think, does a disservice to all the people that have been involved in developing these projects and driving them forward.
The reason that the National Islands Plan was set in place was to address things that happened before Brexit, such as depopulation. So that is also unfair. Could you get back to the committee on how much? Because within the budget for the National Island Spending Plan, that I can't disseminate the detail between the split between the fiscal resource and the capital budget, respectively, which is 1.5 million and 4 million. So if you could get back to the committee on that specific question, that would be really helpful.
Yes, I'm happy to do that.
Thank you.
And very lastly and very briefly, Christine Graham.
Well, actually, I think the Cabinet Secretary touched on it, and I think, you know, in fairness, have you any estimate of how much COVID has knocked back all these plans when for 2 years everything was practically on hold? I'm not just talking about finance, I'm talking about practicalities, and nobody could move anywhere.
I don't know if you're looking for definitive figures there, but I mean, I think in terms of the resource, I mean, we were on an emergency footing and really trying to deal with the immediate crises that we faced, like I say, quite rightly. So I think it was really important that we did that work and again pivoted some of the resource that we had to ensure that we could deal with that as best as we could.
Thank you. That concludes our questions. As always, 90 minutes seems a long session, but we could probably have covered another night. Alistair.
Yeah, thank you, Commissioner. Just briefly, to pick up on the point that was made, and I realise there was a lot going on today, but it was really just that the Cabinet Secretary in her evidence mentioned that some of the issues today that we're talking about in terms of island policy or wider island policy, there is an impact from the UK Government. And it was really just, again, to ask, have we had any update on when we might hear from a minister coming to this committee at any point about anything?
The reason I didn't want to go back to that is because the agreement was that after the meeting with the Cabinet Secretary next week on the general remit array, that we would do that.
OK.
Thanks. So, Cabinet Secretary and officials, thank you very much for your time this morning. We now move on to agenda item 3. Which is consideration of a negative SSI, the Bee Disease and Pest Control Scotland Amendment Order 2023. Members will recall that we deferred our consideration of this instrument in order to seek further clarification and information on a number of points. Do any members wish to make any recommendation on the instrument? Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener. We've had clarification. I'm satisfied with what's been provided so far.
OK. Happy to note that. Okay, that concludes our business in public, and we now move into private session, and I suspend the meeting for 10 minutes.